Saat gagasan pendirian Sarinah dicetuskan pada tahun 1962, Bung Karno ingin banyak membuat mercusuar kebangkitan bangsa Indonesia. Sarinah adalah bentuk perwujudan dari kebangkitan ekonomi kerakyatan menuju modernisasi dan internasionalisme. Dari masa ke masa, Sarinah menjadi saksi dari perkembangan Indonesia. Sarinah melihat bagaimana masyarakat bertumbuh dan beradaptasi melalui segala tantangan yang hadir. Sarinah terus menjadi sentra aktivitas bagi masyarakat untuk memasarkan inovasi dan produk dalam negeri di jantung ibu kota. Transformasi Sarinah adalah sebuah momen yang dinanti-nantikan masyarakat Indonesia. Sebuah pusat perbelanjaan yang didesain untuk memberikan ruang bagi produk dalam negeri yang telah dikurasi. Pemugaran gedungnya tetap menjaga kelestarian aspek cagar budayanya, namun interior, fasilitas, dan pengalaman berbelanja akan disesuaikan dengan perilaku konsumen masa kini dan masa depan. Sarinah diharapkan menjadi destinasi wajib kunjung bagi wisatawan dalam dan luar negeri. Ruang rumah Sarinah terbagi menjadi 8 buah segmen lantai. Masing-masing ruang tersebut kami beri nama antara lain Pasar Nusantara, Pusaka, Untayan, Kreasi, Hayat, House of Sarinah, Cakrawala, dan Tanah Nusa. Melalui konsep community mall, Sarinah memberikan ruang publik yang memiliki elemen historical, urban linkages, urban forest, serta urban living. Kami ingin mengajak Anda untuk menjadi bagian dari semangat baru Sarinah. Semangat yang diwariskan oleh para pendiri bangsa untuk bisa menjadikan Indonesia menjadi salah satu sentral ekonomi dunia. Bersama, mari kita tunjukkan kekayaan karya Nusantara kepada dunia. Sarinah, panggung karya Indonesia.
Hai, welcome to Sarinah Jakarta Content Week 2021, sponsored by Brimo.
Hi everyone and welcome to Litbite, the culinary arm of Jakarta Content Week and organized by the Tujuh Ribu Pulau Imaji Foundation and the Frankfurter Bush Mess. We hope that you are all safe and well. Our theme this year is to gather again, and it explores how to gather a creative community, how to collaborate, connect, and thrive during this COVID era. Over 5 days, Litbite brings together a bold mix of writers, publishers, artists, chefs, academics, activists, and creative minds in a feast of words, ideas, and innovation. My name is Janet Denise, and I'm the founder and director of the Ubud Food Festival. And today I'm bringing you an event called From Clay to Table. And I'm going to be introducing you to Marcello, one of the faces behind Gaya Ceramics Studio in Sayan in Ubud. And of course, Gaya is a world-renowned name. They're leaders in artisan bespoke ceramics. Their work can be found in some of the world's most lavish homes. I wish I could add my name to that list yet. Well, actually, your stuff is in my home anyway. They're luxury hotels, renowned restaurants, from Hermes home. Can you imagine that? To Bulgari hotels. So today we're going to chat to Marcello, find out a little bit about his amazing artisan ceramics. I mean, they're pioneers really in ceramics in Bali and across Indonesia. And we're going to see a little bit of video of their studio and hear their stories in creating the perfect plate for an unforgettable meal. So welcome, Marcello.
Thank you, Janet, and hi to everyone.
We've talked a lot about ceramics and artisan products here. So we know that you came from Italy to Bali and set up Gaya Ceramics. So can you tell the story of how you started your production? Where did you start in Bali?
So basically, me and my wife, Michela, came to Bali in the year 2001. And before that, we had a little pottery studio near Milan, in Piacenza, the small town 50 kilometers south of Milan. And we've been lucky enough to be invited by an entrepreneur here in Bali, and the guy invested and helped us to set up the ceramic studio. So when we first arrived in Bali, it was just me, Miki, and my wife. And we started very small. And now after 20 years, we have about a little bit more than 100 employees. And we export worldwide what we do.
Fantastic, fantastic. So tell us about the detail, the design process. I know your wife, Miki, does most of that. Your background is business, is that correct? And then Miki is the design.
Yes, I have a degree in economy and politics. And while Miki, my wife, she's a sculptress as a background. And so she's, Michela, she's our creative director, and I am the CEO of the company. And yeah, basically Miki take care of all the creative development, because what we do is not just selling our own standard collection, which is, in stock and available, but we mainly, I would say 80% of what we do is custom project. So we develop projects based on clients' functional and aesthetic needs. So we do custom and exclusive collection for basically any kind of clientele, mainly is table setting, because as you said before, Janet, we work a lot for hospitality group, hotels and restaurants. And but not only, I mean, we can jump from tiles for flooring, ceramic wallpaper, lighting, art installations, anything that can be done with ceramic, basically we do.
Good. So, I mean, we can see from the little video there that, you know, you really are an artisan studio. I mean, the detail that you see on the ceramics is done by hand, yeah?
Yes. That one thing that keep us that allowed us actually to be flexible and creative and to change our design every day is the handmade process. So we don't use an industrial machinery or casting mold, not because we don't like them, but just because they would limit our creativity and our flexibility in changing the design every day.
So we
do everything by hand, yes. Actually, we do everything by hand. Even clay and glazes are made by us. Basically, we buy raw material from mining company. We try to buy this raw material from Indonesia. So I would say 80% of our raw material comes from Indonesia. And then we process minerals and we create our own porcelain and stoneware and colors and glaze by ourselves.
So you're saying 80% of your raw materials are from Indonesia.
From Belitung, yes.
So the clay that you use is mainly also from Indonesian soil, yeah?
Exactly. Yeah, we are proud of it.
That's good. So what about the amazing glazes? I mean, your glazes are superb and all those goldy finishes and all those beautiful colors. Are they from Indonesia too?
You have to think, Janet, that clays and glazes, they have a very similar structure chemically, but they just change in composition. So yes, the raw material that are forming our glaze are from Indonesian as well. The gold and the lusters are actually precious metal. The gold is 22 karat gold and the platinum is platinum. And those are not actually coming from Indonesia, but they are coming from Italy.
Yeah, they're so beautiful. And I mean, you have a retail store at the front, yeah, where us folk can wander in and buy all your beautiful things, yeah?
Yes, we have a showroom, which is in front of our production studio, and we have our own Gaya standard collection, and we retail it to public, and we are open every single day from 9 to 6.
And so, we were talking about how your, plates, etc., are in the homes of the Hermes family. Tell us some other celebrities who have bought your fantastic products.
But we have some celebrity who came here but I would just name one because it has been the inception of our story. When we were in Italy and we decided to open a ceramic studio, even our parents were not really happy about our decision to start the career. But we did a little exhibition in Milan, and luckily we met Armani, the fashion designer, he was starting his own home collection.
That
was kind of incredible. And luckily, we entered in this collection, and we received an order from Armani Casa, which at that time was 4 bowls and 2 vases. It was really small. But he gave us, the confidence to keep doing what we were doing, and also gave us credit to our families.
Our
family say, so maybe you can do something good out of it.
Yeah. So talking about COVID, hard not to talk about COVID. How has that affected your production right now?
At the moment, we are good. I mean, we had some difficult months in 2020. But actually, we've been able to keep all our staff full time and full salary. And we are also hiring some new guys at the moment, and production is full. What actually help us a lot is that we do export. We do export at least 70% of our production. So there are markets that are still working well. So we never stop our business.
Right now in Indonesia, it's quite a, you call it a trend, you know, to learn ceramics, you know, suddenly enter the craftsman, and because of COVID, everybody wants to make ceramics and sourdough bread, etc. So tell us a bit about your workshops that are around the corner. Yeah, they're very successful.
Exactly. We also have an educational branch. The name is Gaya Ceramic Arts Center. In this educational branch, we run regular classes, I would say pre-COVID, when we had a flow of tourists and the door were open. So we used to run regular classes, private classes, intensive workshops, and also we have a very vibrant artist in residence program. And we do invite artists from all around the world to take like a cultural visa residency. And these artists are coming and they are developing a specific project in ceramic, which is very nice for us because we share passion, and it's an inspiration from us having these artists coming and sharing their ideas and technique to us, and it's also an opposite. So they are also taking from us because they are using our material. They have access to our archives and so on.
They're not running right now, yeah? When do you think you'll set them up again?
We're running, but not with international participants. So we are running with the local community. We are having, at the moment, we are running this fundamental in clay workshop that they last a week. So they are a week long, and they are fundamental and basic classes for beginners, and where you can learn how to throw on the potter's wheel, how to decorate the pot, how to do some basic glazing. They are really well done, and also the community is responding really well.
Are they for beginners, or they have to have some sort of experience first?
Both, I would say. I would say they are targeted for beginners and intermediate.
Yeah, and normally, how many people do you have in your workshops?
We normally can have about 15 people, but at the moment we limit the. Even if the workshop is an open air studio, so we have a lot of space, but at the moment we are limiting to 7-8 people maximum.
Yeah. So, getting back to your ceramics, what do you think is your signature line? What is one particular line you have created that you think is your best, or are they all? I mean, they're all fantastic.
Yes. That's a difficult question because. Our characteristic is not having a specific line. We jump from porcelain to stoneware, we fire in oxidation and reduction, we have glaze research with traditional glazes from China and Japan, we use raku, which is a Japanese technique of the cheese industry. We use lustres, gold and platinum, and so we have so many diverse techniques that it's for me it's almost impossible to pick one.
Yeah, I mean, you know a lot about the design. Do you ever have anything to do with the design, or you just leave it up to Mickey and the team? Do you just say that's your thing? But you obviously understand.
Mickey does the biggest part of the job, but sometimes she needs a little bit of support, and at that moment I mean, she's my wife, so we bring work at home as well, right? So sometimes at dinner we discuss about the shape.
So talking about production on an average week, not necessarily COVID week, I don't know, how many plates are you making?
We can count about 6,000 to 8,000 average piece per month.
6,000 to 8,000.
6,000 to 8,000, yes.
Wow. And
I mean, it looks a big number, but it is not. I mean, considering that we are doing everything by hand, yes, it may be big, but it's not so big.
Wow. So all those items would be fired within that month. Is that possible to do from start to finish in 1 month? Is that, did you hear that? Is it possible to start, you know, throwing the pot and then you do the bisque firing, yeah, then the second firing and glazing, etc.? I mean, can you start a product and finish it within 4 weeks? Is that possible?
So yeah, when you start to throw something, if I start throw a plate today, it's gonna take at least 10 days to have it finished. Because
including firing?
Yeah, because not just because of the firing, because of the drying. I throw a piece today, then it's gonna take at least 1 week to be leather hard, dry, so we can put it back again on the wheel, and we do all the trimmings, all the finishing, and we perfect the shape on the wheel, and that's already a week past. Then we have to wait another week to have the plate completely dry, and then we fire it bisque, and then it takes maybe 1 day or 2 days for the firing. Then we have to glaze, and then we have to fire it again a second time at higher temperature. And then if we want to put the luster, we have to fire it the third time. So as you can see, it takes a while.
The luster, yeah, okay, that's the third one, yeah. have you had any disasters? I mean, they're fragile items. Have you ever had
them? You always have disasters. That's the bad and the beauty of ceramic. I mean, because at the end of the day, with disaster, you learn a lot. You learn how not to have disaster or from mistake. And if you are able to reproduce the mistake, maybe sometimes you open the kiln and you get a nice surprise, or with a glaze that has a defect. And then you like that defect, and then you want to reproduce it. But mainly, yeah, sometimes if you put the pieces inside the kiln when they are still wet, they might explode. So that kind of explosion we have few times, because the water inside the pieces start to boil, and the gas forming inside the piece, they create pressure. And they can make the piece explode. So yes,
remember when we were having all those earthquakes? Did you have any?
We had firing running when there was the big earthquake, and we had all the pieces stuck together because of the glaze at that point of temperature is basically liquid, like a yogurt. So if the piece touch together, then later on when the glaze cool down and become harder, so they basically glue pieces together. So we had like a big blob of pieces.
Oh no, oh gosh. And you mentioned that you do, apart from the homeware products, you do other interior design items like lighting, etc.
Yes, we, because sometimes we are asked not only to develop table setting, but also to implement other accessories for the restaurant itself. Maybe we can do lighting, we do tiles for flooring, and we do ceramic wallpaper, also out of tile and decoration. We do mirror frame. I mean, anything that basically you can do with ceramic, we do vases for flower, centerpiece, anything really.
And like with your designs, do you find what are the more perhaps popular in a way in terms of, you know, you've sort of got the Asian look, and then you've got the, you know, like cups without handles versus cups with handles. Like in Indonesia, is there one that's more popular over the other?
Lately, I would say, if I'm looking at the shop selling, anything with gold lusters and platinum or are really best selling at the moment. But for the project, for restaurant project, really it varies a lot, because any restaurant has a different design idea or food concept. Sometimes we follow interior design aesthetic, or sometimes we follow chefs food concept ideas. And so every time is really different. So lately we did a seafood restaurant in Hong Kong, and all the plates were inspired by underwater world. So sea urchin, anemone, all these kind of things. So every time is different.
Yeah. And you were saying you've been able to keep your full staff during this COVID period, which is pretty fantastic, on full wages,
yes. Fantastic. And also I'm proud also to say that about 60-70% of our staff heritage from my village where we are located, from Sayan, and all of them are trained internally. So we have an internal training program where senior teach the juniors. At the beginning, it was me and Mickey, and now we have this program, and all the new staff are we take care of them from the very beginning.
Fantastic. Do you have any new plans or anything new in the pipeline, or is it more just about focusing on your products?
Plan for the future, you mean, huh?
Yeah. Do you have anything?
Not big ones. Sometimes, I mean, I'm happy with what we have already. So the business is good. The team is fantastic. I've been asked what you see yourself in 10 years from now, and I always say, if it's like that, I'll be happy.
Yeah, fair enough. It's pretty idyllic, isn't it, really? And it's been a great place.
People they keep thinking to grow and to make things bigger, but sometimes it's also good to make just things better.
Yeah,
not just bigger.
True. I agree with that. Yeah. Okay, so just sort of getting back to the idea of so many plates and all that sort of thing. I mean, what sort of size is your studio? Hopefully we'll see that in this interview, but how big is the working space?
The size of my studio, I know, I think is about you know, that I don't really know how big is it.
Because you have a lot of rooms, yeah? You have a lot of different rooms and different areas.
Maybe 3,000 yeah. square meter. Yeah, with all the open spaces also about.
Yeah, and then, and hopefully people will be able to see the main studio area is really beautiful there with the canvas rooftop, like a focus.
You can probably see, I'll show you later on.
Yeah, so hopefully people can see that. Well, thank you. That's been a fantastic conversation. And I do hope that people will drop into your store now that they know it's open and they can come and say hello. Maybe if you're there, they can see the inside part because it's really beautiful.
And also sometimes we offer also tour in the production studio. Normally it was a regular thing pre-COVID. Now we are a little bit more caution because of the pandemic. So if everyone, if somebody wants to visit the studio, they should book it in advance, wear a mask naturally, and we can organize it.
Yeah, and to find out information about the workshops, they go to your website?
Yeah, they can go to our website, and there are split in two, the production studio and the ceramic art center, so they can find all the information in there.
And that's, is that GaiaCeramics.com? Is that correct?
It's GaiaCeramics.com, exactly.
Okay, well, thank you so much. So I'm just going to close off the session. It's been fantastic, and thank you for your fantastic contribution to really to the Indonesian art scene and design scene. So fantastic.
Thank you everyone for listening, and thanks.
And I'll just add that on behalf of Jakarta Content Week, me, Janet Deneef, curator of these sessions, would like to express my heartfelt appreciation, and also to my friend, Marcello, the speaker, and to each and every member of the audience for your participation. Thank you for supporting Litbite. And to our loyal partners who we all love, who made Jack Tent possible. So there are many more interesting events to watch. So join them via Jack Tent's website, www.jacktent.com. And please follow at Jack Tent on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for any and all updates. Stay safe and see you soon. Terima kasih.
Thank you for joining us. We hope you enjoy the session of Sarinah Jakarta Content Week 2021, sponsored by Brimo.
Saat gagasan pendirian Sarinah dicetuskan pada tahun 1962, Bung Karno ingin banyak membuat mercusuar kebangkitan bangsa Indonesia. Sarinah adalah bentuk perwujudan dari kebangkitan ekonomi kerakyatan menuju modernisasi dan internasionalisme. Dari masa ke masa, Sarinah menjadi saksi dari perkembangan Indonesia. Sarinah melihat bagaimana masyarakat bertumbuh dan beradaptasi melalui segala tantangan yang hadir. Sarinah terus menjadi sentra aktivitas bagi masyarakat untuk memasarkan inovasi dan produk dalam negeri di jantung ibu kota. Transformasi Sarinah adalah sebuah momen yang dinanti-nantikan masyarakat Indonesia. Sebuah pusat perbelanjaan yang didesain untuk memberikan ruang bagi produk dalam negeri yang telah dikurasi, Pemugaran gedungnya tetap menjaga kelestarian aspek cagar budayanya, namun interior, fasilitas, dan pengalaman berbelanja akan disesuaikan dengan perilaku konsumen masa kini dan masa depan. Sarinah diharapkan menjadi destinasi wajib kunjung bagi wisatawan dalam dan luar negeri. Ruang rumah Sarinah terbagi menjadi 8 buah segmen lantai. Masing-masing ruang tersebut kami beri nama antara lain Pasar Nusantara, Pusaka, Untayan, Kreasi, Hayat, House of Sarinah, Cakrawala, dan Tanah Nusa. Melalui konsep community mall, Sarinah memberikan ruang publik yang memiliki elemen historical, urban linkages, urban forest, serta urban living. Kami ingin mengajak Anda untuk menjadi bagian dari semangat baru Sarinah. Semangat yang diwariskan oleh para pendiri bangsa untuk bisa menjadikan Indonesia menjadi salah satu sentral ekonomi dunia. Bersama, mari kita tunjukkan kekayaan karya Nusantara kepada dunia. Sarinah, panggung karya Indonesia. Tak pernah